First question, Tom, is what did you actually do before you were in Evergrey?
A lot of different things. But I mean, music-wise, I was only in one band, really, that was something to talk about. Actually, it's nothing to talk about. It's a death metal thing that I was involved in. We actually got a record deal, but we quit before starting to record an album.
We spoke earlier on today, and you were telling me how the band got its name, and how at the very beginning of your career things were very, very hard.
Mm.
And it's just a sort of matter of personal day-to-day survival a lot of the time.
Mm.
Can you give me a more detailed description of that sort of time in your life, what it was like, what sort of things you had to do to get from one day to the next?
I was also fed up with my mom back then, so I moved out of my mom's when I was, I think I just turned 17, so I immediately got my own flat, and I don't really know how, but I got it nonetheless. So, and then, you know, then you had the problem that you had to pay for a rent and get your own food. And I was really proud, you know, very stubborn and very proud of myself. So I would never go to my mom's house and ask for food or money or anything like that. So I remember one incident when I lived at a house that was like 50 meters away from a store here in Gothenburg. And I didn't have any food that day, and I was too proud to go home to my mom and ask for, you know, even the slightest piece of bread. So I went to the store, and I stole a packet of spaghetti, and and I got caught. And I had a bag with me, and the shop owner said, "Give me your bag," and I gave him my bag, and then he said, "Now I want 500 kroners in order for you to get your bag back, or I'll call the cops." And I was like, you know, I was born in Angered, which is a sort of hood. And I was like, yeah, if I can call the cops then. So he called the cops and they came and handcuffed me and took me outside the store where all my friends were standing in, you know, for a packet of fucking spaghetti. So I had to go to jail for that for 6 hours. And the police officer was only laughing when he was writing a report all the time. So, yeah, that was really stupid.
You're now the lyric writer for the band, the main lyric writer for the band. Many fans have written in to say they find your words very emotionally moving, something very seldom seen in a lot of metal bands nowadays. They wonder, do you use personal experiences as a guide for your lyrics or to help you tell the story? And if so, can you give an example?
Most definitely. I mean, and the first time I really did that was for the song Dark Discovery, where as I said in the other interview, that's where... was when we lost a family member to cancer, and that really influenced that song. And that at that time, I discovered that I was not about writing about fucking swords and slaying dragons and, you know, blowing stuff up. I was more the kind of guy that wanted to write about something that either happened to me or somebody close to me. So, and I think it also made Evergrey very sincere and very honest. And I think that is one of the major things that are sticking with people listening to Evergrey today. So,
looking back, what's your favorite Evergrey album to date, and why?
This is an extremely hard question, but I think it is my favorite. I mean, what is favorite? Favorite recording or favorite listening to? Because I don't listen to them very much.
Which one sort of sticks in your mind?
I think Solitude, Ominous Tragedy, sticks in my mind because it was the first time where we actually decided what we wanted to do. Now we have the formula. Now we're going to record it. We had all the songs. We were really prepared. For the first album, I had to concentrate on trying to sing, and as well as being the first album with all the other crap going on. We didn't really know what we were doing at that time. But for the second album, we were really determined on what we wanted to accomplish. And I think we did as well. And I sang better and everything was smoother, basically. So I think that is the album that is sort of felt like the first real album we recorded. So I think that is one sticking with me the most.
On a similar theme to that, there's a question from one of your fans, Joel Decatur from Virginia in the USA. And he wants to know, if you lost the ability to write, record and perform music, what would you want to pursue elsewhere in your life? Is there something else you'd like to do with your life?
And that includes producing music as well.
Yes, outside of music. What do you think you'll...
I don't really know. I don't have a plan B. I guess it's dying then.
Aldi, another huge Evergrey fan, this time from Croatia, appreciates that when you sing with your soul. And he wonders how you get that level of emotion in your voice. Do you dedicate a song to someone when you sing it, or an event when you sing it?
What's the sort of key? I'm just singing about things that I believe in and things that I've experienced myself, or once again, things that, you know, have been experienced by somebody close to me. You know, so it makes it real for myself. Then it's not hard to sing about. It's just like telling a story, an everyday story. And it's not hard to make people believe something that is true.
And on a similar line of inquiry, I guess, Teresa, another fan, has noticed that in the Evergrey booklets, you greet all your sisters, a lot of them, but there aren't any brothers. A lot of people say they benefit from being the only boy or girl in a large family. Teresa wonders if growing up as the only boy between so many girls actually affected your personality, your creativity, or your way of becoming a musician.
I guess it would have if we were growing up together, but we weren't, because half of the sisters, or three of them, are living with my dad, and only one of them were living with me. So I've had a sort of normal sister-brother growing up. But I mean, if that were the case, that I would have grown up with all the sisters around me, I'm sure that being in this band would have wiped all the positive things out. So,
look into the future. What do you sort of see over the next 5 years, or what would be your aspirations for the next 5 years of Evergrey? Where do you see the band going?
I mean, a very boring answer, of course. I mean, to get bigger and get more known and have more people listening to Evergrey and see. I mean, I don't know how long we're going to do this. I mean, I see this DVD as a good milestone in our career, and we'll keep on doing this until we don't find it fun anymore.
And do you have particular things that you'd like, sort of, you say this is a milestone with the DVD. Mm. Where do you sort of see the next step of the band going?
I mean, probably going places where we haven't been yet, like South America. We haven't been in South America. We're probably never going to Japan, so we have to be somebody's guitar tech in order to go there. And sell a million albums would be cool as well.
Stefan, who was one of the fans at the DVD concert, notes that your music and your lyrics are quite dark. He wonders what kind of person you would describe yourself as. To maybe do that, I'd like you to pick five words that would sort of describe you the best. In other words, name your own rulers of the mind, I guess.
Suicidal, fat, depressed, whining, a crybaby. That was probably the most honest answer I can give you.
All right, another honest answer then. There's another question is, if you're a porn star, which would be your preferred position?
I don't like sex at all.
That's not an honest answer.
No. No, it isn't. That's the only one you're going to get.
Going on to, again, the future, I'm just interested, have you got any particular musical styles that you'd like as a person, as a musician, to develop outside of the Evergrey boundaries?
That's what is really cool with Evergrey, I think. You know, besides being stuck in the sort of hard rock genre, or whatever you want to call it, we can pretty much do anything we want in Evergrey. So, I mean, we have all the sort of acoustic elements and the pop elements and the harsher elements as well. But I mean, then we take it maybe to the extreme in other projects that I don't really like to talk about right now.
And have you got any other things going on outside of Evergrey that you'd like to maybe do in the next couple of years? Anything on the back boiler?
I might have.
What do you think's the biggest accomplishment for yourself through Evergrey? What do you feel that is the one thing that you've really got out of it?
I think it was, you know, becoming a singer, actually, you know. Because
really?
When I went into this, you know, I was a guitar player, and I kept on feeling that I was a guitar player when up until the third album, I think. Then I become a singer, because, you know, when people were asking me during the first album, what do you do? Oh, I play guitar. Oh yeah, and I sing as well. But now it's probably pretty much the other way around. So becoming a singer is probably the biggest personal accomplishment I've made.
And one final question, this is my own question, so I'll chuck it in to end up with. I didn't see it until the first time I downloaded it the other day off the website. It was the video for the song I'm Sorry. mm-hmm. in which you were present at your own funeral or stroke wake. For me, that's a really numbing idea. Your life can end at any moment. Most of us have either been close to death or been close to somebody who's been close to death at some stage. If you were to die tomorrow but were able to attend your own funeral, what do you think people would be saying about you?
Hopefully I would have friends that were would be going to my funeral, and the band members being four of them. And I guess that would be all kinds of ironic comments about me, because I, you know, we're not very serious people at all. We sort of get all our crap out of us through the music. But I mean, I guess it would be comments like the man who did his laundry until he died and stuff like that. You know, hopefully kind stuff. It might be things like I'm a Nazi and dictator as well, but then I won't hear it because I'm dead.